This is a forum where we are going to have conversations with people who are doing important stuff. But this conversation is going to be open not just to our students and faculty, but to the entire community. And we'll be looking at issues of importance to the country. And my goal is to have a conversation, not a lecture, to understand a little bit about what motivates people and why they are doing what they are doing. So today I am delighted to have Professor Subramanian. I still call him Professor, not CEA, because he is a professor. So it's 8 o'clock and we are also going live on Facebook. So hello everyone on Facebook. Delighted to have you here. Professor, please have a seat. Okay. So without wasting any time, Subbu, let's think about this. 5 trillion in 5 years. We are 3 trillion today. So in 5 years, if I get my compounding right, we are talking about 11% a year nominal growth rate. Yeah. And you said we should grow at 8% real with maybe 3% inflation. That doesn't seem hard to do. I think we can do it. Is that right?
Yeah, I think so. In fact, another way in which I tried to look at this is that the first $1 trillion that India created, it took us 55 years to create that first trillion. And from 1.7 to 2.7 happened in the space of, you know, from 2014 to 2019. So if we can basically, you know, create a, of course, I understand actually I'm not really comparing apples and apples because of the diminishing returns and all the other stuff that we talk about. But, you know, if we look at it from a lay perspective, you know, if we can create the first trillion in 55 years and then in 1/11th of the time effectively another trillion, then I think it's possible to, as you rightly said, it's possible to create this, you know, the go to 5 trillion. And I remember from my, you know, classes in psychology that I took when I was doing my MBA, that in order for the motivation levels to be, I think, to be best, the goal should neither be too easy nor should it be too much of a stretch.
Okay. And it should be achievable. You should be able to see it, but not touch it right away.
There should be, I think, it maybe 10 to 15% stretch is something that actually is good.
You mentioned MBA. Where do you get your MBA?
Well, I actually...
Another place?
to my defense, actually, ISB was not there at the time. You know,
okay,
you're dating me clearly, but I graduated in 1999. So 2 years senior to the senior most batch, you know, the founder batch at ISB.
Yeah, okay.
And I, you know, as you would like me to, I'm not going to name the place.
Yeah, okay, all right, excellent. Your economic survey came out not too long ago, and there were a number of things you mentioned. So I'm going to go to maybe two or three main ideas in there. The first one was...
But if you'd allow me, just let me sort of give you the background behind why, what we did, or maybe...
It has to be short.
Yes, we will be. You know, when we sat down to actually decide about the survey, I think one thing was that was very clear was that this will be the first survey for a new government. Whether or not it will actually be the same government returning or not, we were not sure when we had started writing. But I think it was clear that this will be, it gives us an opportunity to sort of set an agenda for 5 years.
That's right. And you mentioned blue sky thinking.
Yes.
What does that mean?
So I think, you know, us researchers generally do get this idea. Think about actually just, you know, lying on the grass here at ISB, gazing at that blue sky. You know, when you're in that kind of relaxed state, you know, I think your creativity is flowing. You're basically not inhibited at all. You're thinking about, you know, if suppose I could remove all my constraints, and oftentimes, and this is something I've always believed, all the boundaries are in the mind.
All the boundaries are in the mind.
And if I actually, you know, think in an unfettered manner, and that's what really the blue sky thinking captures, you just lie down relaxed, you know, not a worry in the world, just gaze at the sky and think about, you know, how could the world be different without any constraints. And that's what, you know, blue sky thinking really captures. And what we tried to capture here is, at least for the next 5 years, can we get over, you know, some of the whatever models that might have been talked about earlier? And that's why, if you would notice, you know, in the abstract of the first chapter itself, you know, I've sort of marked it out by saying that this is a departure from traditional, and I've, you know, consciously chosen those words, traditional Anglo-Saxon thinking. So that's what I felt, that let's be unfettered and let's just think with a clean slate.
I see. So you say, let's think about without constraints, see what is possible, mm-hmm. and then see what is stopping us
right.
from being possible, and then perhaps remove constraints one
yeah.
by one.
Right.
So that's how you're thinking.
That's sort of the, I mean, I think captures, I'll give you one more metaphor, and this is something which helped me when I was trying to sort of lay out what I would want to talk about. It's a metaphor that I've been using to think about an uncertain world. You know, if all of us as kids have basically, you know, ran after frisbees, right? You know, you throw a frisbee and then you run to catch it. So catching that frisbee, let's say, is the goal. Now, if I throw the frisbee in this direction, obviously I'm not going to run in that direction. So I have to run in the direction of the frisbee, number one. Number two, you know, but while I run, I cannot just keep my eyes closed. I have to actually keep my eyes open, because the frisbee, you know, swerves in the wind, really moves around, and I have to keep my eyes on that so that I can continuously recalibrate. Given the direction that I've set out, I have to recalibrate in order to be able to catch that. And so now this metaphor, catching that frisbee, is basically that $5 trillion goal, the vision that was set by the Honorable Prime Minister. The direction in which to run is, in my opinion, actually is the blueprint that we're laying out. And then, you know, but in an uncertain world, which is why I'm using this example of a frisbee which, you know, swerves around, you can't basically just be regimented saying, I'm going to only set out on this path. You have to, you know, tactically maneuver as well.
Be ready for changes,
actually. And that's why, you know, when I'll talk about, you know, there's this chapter on uncertainty and investment, but I'll come to that later. But it's important to therefore recalibrate continuously, and some tactical tools are important. And that's where I sort of borrowed from some of our strategy colleagues, saying, you know, there's a vision. To achieve that vision, we need a blueprint. But that blueprint cannot be regimented. You have to have tactical tools to recalibrate continuously into it.
You said our colleagues. You mean our colleagues at ISB?
Well, I, again,
some of them. All right.
Unfettered thinking. Why should I actually keep my boundaries to colleagues only at ISB?
Okay.
You know, strategic.
So it's very good. So I noticed that you used the symbolism of frisbee. You didn't say Arjuna with a.
I don't mind that at all. In fact, you know, I.
But Arjuna can't do this, right? You're asking Arjuna to.
No, if you actually, so if, you know, if we understand that it was, you know, Arjuna was supposed to be looking down, he was not looking at the fish's eye, supposed to be looking at the water, and the water is actually moving around.
So that's better than frisbee. Get rid of the frisbee thing. I like that better. Isn't that right, guys?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, there's enough of that in the survey anyways, and you know,
Okay, so the survey has a lot of symbolism, as was the budget speech by Nirmala Sitharaman.
Yeah.
But I have to say that I was hoping when she started saying, oh, when there's an elephant, we want to make sure that only 2 bowls of rice are enough, but if the elephant goes in and starts trampling, you won't get enough rice. So I said, oh, tax cuts are coming. And then you increase the taxes. Well, what the heck is that? Can you please explain this?
You're going to get me in trouble.
That was the whole point.
So let me first talk about, I'll come
Let's
to...
Let's see how he gets out of this, okay?
I'm seasoned enough now.
Ah, good.
So the tax parts actually were in the part B of the speech. And the budget speech has typically 2 parts, the part A and the part B. For me, the highlight of the speech was the part A, where she talked about the virtuous cycle which was there in the survey.
Yeah.
She talked about, you know, investment as basically important to putting that virtuous cycle together. And, you know, as the speech was going on, I was, you know, the analytics were being put out. The word investment was used 33 times.
Yeah.
The word infrastructure was used like, and I think close to that many number of times. The reason I actually mentioned this is infrastructure, as we know, you know, from work in economics, that in public infrastructure has the effect of crowding in private investment. And the economic survey talked about private investment especially. So let me focus on the measures, because what the survey did was
you want to show a chart or something?
I'll just come to that in a minute. But the, you know, deliberately we did not get into some of the details. Again, when we had to make a choice, right, about what to leave out, and that's one of the hardest decisions oftentimes actually in, you know, so we felt that let's this survey be about the big picture, making sure that what should be the strategic direction. For instance, you know, we could have decided to, let's say, go into specifics about, you know, what to do on investment, specifics about what, let's say, on the banking sector, specifics about agriculture or many of the other things, but we decided actually not to.
I'm sorry, that's what a budget is, right? Budget is
exactly
supposed to be
no, but you know,
but this is strategic thinking,
correct?
So why
which
are
is
we mixing up budget with
no, but I want you to, you know, Bhagwan, just I think I'm sure you appreciate this, that it could have, one could have written a survey which basically had, let's say, each of those sectors getting into those sectors. Instead, we made a choice to stick to a theme. And that theme was, as you would, so the cover page actually captures all of that. We said shifting gears. Why? Because we've been growing at about close to 7%. And, you know, so we've been running this car, let's say, on a third, fourth gear. But now we said, okay, let's move on to fifth gear now. Come on. And that's basically what we said, let's shift gears. And the if you saw in the cover page as well, we showed all these interlinking gears, and that's something I'll, you know, maybe if you actually, so if you can just have the presentation
up. Show us what you're going to do.
So
with
the presentation
investment.
Up, so if you can just move
what
on.
What is in your plan that will move us from 7 to 8%? What is it that will increase investments?
So this is what I basically said, the shifting gears through a virtuous cycle. Let me just explain what is the departure. So this, I'll let me leave all this. Let me come to, so this is the, and am I blocking people?
Don't worry, you can stand up and walk around.
Okay, so I think I'm a lot more comfortable in ISB actually standing than sitting. Okay, so this is the essence of the idea that we were trying to, which is that investment, you know, is the driver of that cycle. And if I can borrow your phone, Bhagwan, I'm not carrying my phone now. But okay, so I'm sure all of you have a phone like this, right? Everybody, ask yourself, what does this phone do to your life? Apart from obviously being able to, let's say, show it as an item of conspicuous consumption, let's leave that aside. What does it really do? Enhances productivity. Right? You can actually go and set your alarm, you can make notes on it, you can make, you know, if you want to record voice memos, you can go on WhatsApp, you don't need multiple tools. What is this? This is an investment, right? It's an investment that enhances your own productivity. And that's the nature of any investment. That investment basically enhances productivity to start with. And I'm going to, you know, lest this is seen as an opinion, I'll actually show some evidence on this. So investment, first thing, leads to increases in productivity. And without being agnostic, without sort of getting into whether this is labor intensive, capital intensive, you know, we don't need to get into those details. But investment enhances productivity. And productivity then is important for exports. I'm sure you guys have learned in your international economics classes that I hope that's not a Chinese phone, Bhagwan.
All phones are made in China.
Okay, there we go. So, that answer helps me a lot. Why are we buying those? Because, and you guys know very well, if you're getting the same quality at a lower price, or at the same price we get a higher quality, that's when we actually buy imported stuff, right? Same way, if our firms need to be exporting, they need to be either producing the same stuff at a lower price, same quality, or at the same price they need to be delivering higher quality, which has to be then about productivity. And that's the key.
Can you say something about, when you say investment, are you talking about private investment?
Yes.
Not government investment.
No. So I am making a distinction between, as I was saying earlier, about infrastructure. Right? Infrastructure has this you know, and some of my own work, for instance, I've looked at as well. Public infrastructure has this, you know, role of crowding in private investment. To that extent, actually,
tell us what crowding in means.
Okay, I think that's a you know, it's jargon that we all. So let me explain what is a crowding out first, you know, and then maybe think about crowding in. So let's say that, you know, two siblings in a household, and let's say the elder brother, you know, and the younger brother both want to go and set up shop, you know, start a new business. Dad has so much, has created money. If suppose the elder sibling goes and takes 60% of that money, there's only 40% left for the younger sibling. And, you know, notice the shade I'm throwing by elder brother versus younger brother. if the elder brother takes away more, there's less left for the younger brother, right? That's your typical crowding out. But suppose the elder brother goes and invests, suppose, you know, he goes and creates a shop that's, let's say, a garment shop, you know, and the younger brother wants, basically, is a tailor. So now I'm constructing this example on the fly, so hopefully it comes out right. But so the elder brother investing more in this case, which is basically maybe his garment shop becoming bigger, enables the younger brother. That is sort of, in some sense, crowding in, an example for crowding in. If on the other hand, the elder brother basically goes and does something which is completely unrelated to the younger brothers, the elder brother takes up bigger, you know, maybe 60-70%, there's less left for the younger brother. And that's your crowding out. Now, infrastructure is basically an example of crowding in, while typically when we talk about, the reason we worry about fiscal deficit, and that's one of the first things that come up in budget deliberations, is the effect of crowding out, because fiscal deficit is effectively, you must have heard this particular song in Bollywood, says, you know, aamdani athanni kharcha rupaiya. Remember? How many of you remember this? Okay. So aamdani athanni kharcha rupaiya, which is actually oftentimes what governments, you know, sort of have to do, because, you know, there is, as we say, there is a fiscal multiplier, you know, don't want to get into that. But for government, it's okay to actually have a deficit. But if the deficit is too large, then you're basically tapping into the same source of savings, domestic savings, there's less left for the private sector. So that's sort of
So substitution, you're saying,
yes.
If there's substitution, if you have this, you can't have this.
Correct.
That's crowding out.
Correct.
But what we call complementarity.
Yes.
That if I have this, if I have a machine,
correct,
then I can work on the machine and become more productive.
Yes.
That's crowding in.
Crowding in,
is
exactly.
Right? Okay.
So in some, I think complementarity is actually even better to the way to say it. Think about left shoe and right shoe, you know. The left shoe and the right shoe together are actually a lot more valuable.
Okay,
than
so if you're going to increase taxes on us, how is the investment
going to
go up?
I'm going to come to that. No, that's, so I, can't you see, Bhagwan, I don't want to answer your question.
Okay, what are you going to do to increase private investment?
Let me finish this part. So, the exports, you know, is important. I'll show you some evidence. Actually, productivity leads to exports. And productivity, investment and productivity also create jobs. Now, this is where oftentimes there's more debate. You know, when you look at it in a silo, for instance, this is an example that is given, right? ATMs replacing tellers, right? And people say technology leads to job loss. The contention that, and I'm going to show you evidence, is that is, if you're looking at it only in one part of the value chain. If you look at the entire value chain, and you know, the Milind will actually, hopefully will, you know, not say that I'm not, what I'm saying is right, but I'm getting into sort of some of this value chain, you know, as, so if you now take into account the, yes, when you just look at it in this partial sense of, let's say, the tellers being replaced by the ATM machine, it looks like there's a job loss. But if you start counting in the fact that in order to produce that ATM machine, there was R&D that was done, people who did R&D, there were people who actually manufactured that ATM machine, people who transported that ATM machine, and people who actually are still required to take the cash to the ATM machine, and so on, right? When you take all that into account, the entire value chain, there are jobs being created. And that's the point that needs to be made, because, and this was motivated, if you look at China, I mean, I'm going to show you a chart there, the investment rates touched to 50% of GDP. Which means out of every 100 yuan that they were making in terms of the, you know, in the economy, they were investing almost 50% of that into and in the process creating a bunch of jobs, millions of jobs. And that's the point that we basically wanted to. So when you have exports and jobs, basically there's income, purchasing power, which we basically use to go and buy our pants, shirts, watches, this, that, and the other, and that's what creates demand. Anticipating that people will now actually demand more, firms will invest more, and that's how this virtuous loop basically proceeds. Now, in contrast, and you know, if you looked at what happened during the financial crisis, for instance, the same thing works in a vicious loop, because people lost jobs. When they lost jobs, they basically couldn't demand enough. Anticipating lower demand, firms cut down on investment, and then actually lower investment, therefore they had to cut more jobs, and the vicious cycle was operating. That's one of the, so I'm going to come back to that just in a minute. That's the two key departures, which is, and here I actually think my training as an engineer first, and then going into economics really, you know, really sort of helps me here, because somehow I have found that economists are just too fascinated by this concept of equilibrium. Engineers, in engineering you learn a lot about actually, you know, phenomena outside equilibrium as well. And the way I think about it, let's say, you know, you're a sculptor, you went and created a very, very beautiful statue. You fell in love with the statue, but the statue is not the real, it's not the real person. So this concept of equilibrium is a beautiful statue, but then, you know, economists have just fallen in love with that statue without, while forgetting that the statue is not a real person. And that's what we wanted to sort of depart from and say, let's talk about the real wide world, guys. And that real worlds, real economies are neither in, you know, they're not in equilibrium. Either they're in virtuous cycles when they're growing well, you know, China, East Asia, etc., or they're in vicious cycles when, you know, a financial crisis occurs. So that's one key departure that, that we've... The second, as I just have explained, is rather than thinking about these as economies of silos, right, various different, let me solve the job problem separately, let me go and solve the export problem separately, let me go and solve the demand problem separately. No, these are basically complementary to each other, you know, and that's the evidence quickly I'm going to show you here. So this is, for instance, let's, you know, in the chapter, by the way, there is charts for other East Asian economies as well. This is just, and I'm going to just show you China, and that's what I, you know, in the interest of time. Look at calendar time here, 1980 to 2020, basically 2018 actually, the data ends there. What you notice is that consumption to GDP fell down significantly, you know, secularly coming down with, of course, a little bit. Savings and investment, on the other hand, went up significantly. In fact, savings outpaced investment. You know, there's concept of precautionary savings, which we'll basically get into later, but maybe not. But savings outpaced investment, and this is really important. The traditional, or the most sort of what I learned during my PhD program, was more about consumption driving economic growth. But that's not what you find here. You don't find this even for East Asia either. And when you actually, you know, plot this using another scale here, which I'm using, this is log GDP per capita. This is calendar time. But if I do it using what is called development time, what is this? I'm doing, this is, by the way, log to the base 10, all of you understand. So when I have 10 to the power 3, that's 1,000, a GDP per capita of 1,000. Notice that as you proceed more on the x-axis, which means the economy, the GDP per capita is increasing, which means the economy is actually becoming more and more developed. Crucially, what you find is that as the economy is basically becoming more and more developed, it's pouring a larger proportion of its GDP into savings and investment and exporting more. This is the virtuous cycle that we're talking about, because if, on the other hand, these lines were flat, it could have been, if these lines were flat, then irrespective of, that's your equilibrium, that irrespective of what the GDP per capita was, the proportion of exports to GDP, proportion of investment and savings to GDP is the same. That's the equilibrium. And just to...
I have a question, Professor.
Yeah.
Okay. Two things. You mentioned PhD, so I want to remind everyone that Professor got his PhD at University of Chicago. Some of the people at University of Chicago are squirming as you are saying these things. Equilibrium doesn't work and all of those things. So I also went to University
yes,
of Chicago.
Yes, I was going to mention that.
I'm also squirming a little. But here's a question for you. The question is, why does investment have to be come from domestic savings? Why can't it
good
come from
very good
foreign
question.
Savings? Because then you can even have high consumption,
absolutely,
which actually increases demand.
In
so
fact,
why
I'm
not have both?
I'm going to come to that, actually. I'm going to come to that. It's a very good point. But let me, on the more philosophical point of my, you know, my teacher squirming,
Some of your teachers.
Some of
one them. Of your teachers is very happy. Can you mention who that is? We'll come to that.
Okay. So here's, I think this is where I see the difference between you know, sort of researching and policy making. You know, I can be in love with a model when I'm actually, you know, when I'm researching.
He's talking about mathematical models. Don't get him wrong. Just wanted to make sure it's all on video, so you know.
No, Bhagwan, why is spoiling the pun?
Kavita's in US, his wife.
Okay, but when I'm sort of, you know, or I or anybody else actually has to deal with the real world, I think you've got to, you know, just recognize it for what it is. And now, your
you
other
mean,
point
give
actually.
A, give up on rigor.
No.
No, okay.
No, no, I don't think actually, see, this is, in fact, you know, I mean, maybe this is a conversation for later time, that rigor does not necessarily just mean math. I've always believed that, you know. Math is finally just a language. Rigor is about how many, it's like peeling the layers of the onion. How many, you know, ifs do I ask, basically?
Yeah.
Or like a grandmaster saying, how many moves do I think ahead? If you ask me a question, do I have an answer to the answer if you have a question, you know, and then I have an answer like that. That's basically what...
In fact, these are all stories. We are all telling stories.
Absolutely.
It's theory is a story.
Yes.
And in some sense, this is a major part of your economic survey, is that we need to change the narrative.
Exactly.
In this country.
Exactly.
We need to think differently. We need to think about taxes not as a burden, but
yes,
taxes as a responsibility.
Correct.
And your other professor,
and as taxpayers, as people whom should be respected equally, and I, you know, this was a question that I was asked in just taking a digression on NDTV, saying, so in fact these were some very good ideas that Bhagwan had given, saying, why don't we respect our taxpayers, you know? And so the question basically was asked, saying, oh, your survey talks about you know, about naming roads after taxpayers, after, you know, airports, etc. Were you kidding? Was the question that I was asked. And I actually responded with equal seriousness, saying, no, I was not kidding. I was, you know, damn serious about it. Because, you know, if we can really appreciate those that create jobs in the economy, those that basically help to, let's say, create a new business model, why not appreciate those people that eventually create the dollars or the rupees which is basically spent on welfare spending? Money does not grow on trees.
We should have Narayanmurthy Airport instead of...
Yes, you know...
for example.
I did not say...
For example.
So to get back, right, that's the point, I think, the point that Bhagwan was saying about why do you need necessarily domestic savings? I think that's a very good point. And in fact, if you notice in the budget, there is a move to try and basically tap money, do a sovereign bond issuance. And this is precisely, it is just, you know, putting in action the idea and the question that Bhagwan has asked, which is currently... In India, the domestic savings rate is not that high. You know, it will become high because there are demographic factors, and I'll come to that just in a minute. But in order to trigger this cycle, in order for this virtuous cycle has to be triggered first. And then, you know, as long as you're actually sort of providing those necessary catalyzers, it'll continue. But triggering that means that investment has to happen because that's the central driver. And that's where the idea was that let's go and tap into foreign savings. Why? Because right now, if you look at basically the 10-year, let's say, in, you know, 10-year government of India security rate in, you know, in India, is about 8%, 7.5% to 8%. In contrast, if you go and check basically, let's say, you know, France, Germany, Japan, the nominal rates are negative. You know, I'm not talking about real rates here. Nominal rates are negative. So now there is basically, you know, traders in treasury, you know, talk about carry trades. This is like a carry trade in some sense.
So borrow where capital is cheap,
yes,
and invest where the opportunities
invest.
Are there.
Exactly, exactly.
So you see a lot of opportunities,
yes,
in India.
Yes.
And
especially in, because the budget, for instance, talked about 100 lakh crores of infrastructure investment, which is 100 trillion. So
And you said in your economics...
But let me, Bhagwan, one more point to your question, because I think, you know, very profound
make
question.
Make it fast, okay?
Yes.
Because we have to go to audience.
No,
remember.
No, I agree, actually. Yeah. So the other part, which is that in this virtuous cycle that I know, exports, why is exports important? Because if you have to... The risk with just relying too much on foreign savings is that that can sort of, you know, affect your macroeconomic stability. Because, you know, there is basically feedback that comes in. So, to a certain level, well-managed is fine. But if you let, you know, and this is what, for instance, the East Asian economy suffered. If you let all your investment or a large part come in from foreign savings, then you expose yourself to vulnerability. So notice the nuance I'm talking about. I am saying let's use the foreign savings to trigger this particular virtuous cycle. But let's not completely rely on that, because that has actually feedback effects and, you know, it can create a situation of possible volatility. Instead, what we do is we basically try and, because demographics are favorable, and I'll, you know, maybe I'll come back to that if we have time.
So just light the fire.
Light the fire, but depend on domestic savings. But if you're going to depend on domestic savings, like a household, if you're going to save a lot, then you're not going to consume as much. If you're not going to consume as much domestically, where is the demand going to come from? The demand will have to come from exports, therefore. And therefore, exports is a critical element of this model. That if your domestic consumers are going to be saving a lot more, domestic population are going to saving a lot more, they're not going to be consuming as much. Therefore, for this virtuous cycle, the demand cannot come as much from domestic consumption. Therefore, exports becomes a critical part of this model.
Okay, so let me go to a slightly different thing, which is part of your survey that I didn't understand very well, but it seems important, which is you mentioned a point that there is a gap in India from firms, small firms, how they become big firms. There
right.
is a big gap. They don't make big enough. And you said it has something to do with our labor laws.
Yes.
And then I heard that this was music to my ears, because the economists have been talking about this for decades. But then I looked at what you guys propose, and that doesn't seem far enough to me. I mean, minimum wages instead of 18, you have 4. What the heck is that? That's nothing. When you're talking about labor laws, you have to really go and dig it.
Yeah.
Is there a thinking in the government that we are moving in that direction?
So I think, you know, let me clarify this, right? So first explain the point that Bhagwan is talking about, and then, you know, talk about what is the solution that we are. So this is a chart that I think is very important, which is, so here we have basically data from organized manufacturing. There is this database called the Annual Survey of Industries, which basically does, you know, looks at all manufacturing factories. Now, the split here is, so you see these orange kind of bars and these purple bars. The orange ones are basically for firms that have less than 99 employees. And the purple ones are for firms that are more than 99 employees. Now, remember, so in the survey, while acknowledging that firms with more than 99 employees are really not big by international standards, With that caveat, we still call this large in some sense, because typically in an international sense, 1,000 or more is actually what is called a large
okay,
firm.
Okay, so tell us why 99 is important. That's crucial.
Yeah, I'll come to that just in a minute. But let me explain the key pattern here, right? So what I'm showing here is by number of firms, employment, and value added. So notice that these quote-unquote small firms, less than 99, you know, account for 84.3% of all firms, which means if you pick up 100 firms, you know, in manufacturing, organized manufacturing, close to 85 of them are employing less than 99 employees. So these are dominating the landscape. But what is their contribution to employment? Their contribution to employment is less than 25%. And what about their contribution to value added? Value added is, the simple way of thinking about it is just plain rice cooked versus biryani. You know, eventually productivity comes from, basically from value added, you know, biryani versus plain rice. So their contribution to value added is less than 12%. Now, this is there's a myth that prevails that, oh, you know, it's our small firms that create a lot of jobs. The fact is small firms destroy as many jobs as well. So the net job creation is very, very low. And the 100 threshold is important, Because a lot of, you know, labor laws, for instance, apply for firms that have more than 100 employees.
100 or more.
100 or more. 100 or more. And this is where, this is, so keep that in mind when I come. Let me show you this slide, I think, which is, when I looked at this slide, it was actually in some sense just hit me, you know. So what I'm plotting here is age, firm age, okay? We are normalizing, and you know, normalizing is basically just making it same for firms, you know, in three economies, which is US, Mexico, and India. So they all are starting at the same point, which is basically one, when these firms are less than 5 years old, okay? When they're less than 5 years old. Notice what happens to the firms in the United States. When that firm, when a firm becomes 40 years old, it is creating more than 7 times as much jobs, okay, as it was when it was young, less than 5 years old. Mexico.
Come on.
Mexico creates basically twice as many. Why I say that is because India creates 40% more only. In other words, if you had 100 employees here, 140, you know, when the firm is 40 year old, 700 plus in the US and 200 in Mexico.
So let me clarify. This is an important point. Let me clarify. Just hang on there for a second.
Yeah. Now, by the way, let's a quick clarification. The usual question comes is there's a bunch of other factors, confounding factors.
No, that's not. My question is very simple.
No, not your question. Others, actually, just to clarify, this is basically, we can talk about this. So any confounding factor, it's been taken care of here, actually.
Okay, but here's the thing. This point that there are more small firms than large firms is just a power law that exists everywhere. That's not the new point.
Right.
I think what you're pointing out is that in India, firms that are small stay small.
Yes.
Whereas the firms that are small in the US eventually become big.
Correct.
And that has something to do with this threshold.
Yes.
So now tell me, what is about the labor law?
Correct. Okay. So quick, just for you to latch on to this idea, think about the metaphor of infants versus dwarfs. Infants are those that basically grow to become giants. Dwarfs, they age, but they continue to be small, right? Now, I'll use one, why, so the Bhagwan's question, why is it that this is the situation in India? Everywhere, yes, small firms do account for a lot of employment, but they grow. Think about, let's say, you know, all of us maybe as kids or maybe our kids, when they learned cycling, we gave them these support wheels, right? And when the kid basically, maybe in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or maybe within a month, we took away those support wheels so that the kid could basically become an independent biker. Now think about, suppose as a parent, I had said that, you know, or I or any one of us had said that you can keep your support wheels forever, the kid would never go to learn to basically, you know, sort of become an independent biker. Or said differently, if I basically say, you know, I tell my son or daughter saying, you only play inside home because if you go outside, there are big kids out there who will basically hit you and slam you.
Okay, so, now you're tempting me because
coming
there's
to that.
So many things where we have kept the support and we have never taken, I mean, look
exactly.
At all the subsidies.
Exactly.
And look at all the, shall I say, quotas?
Yes.
And I mean,
no, in the context of employment, I'm actually within that limited point I'm
okay,
saying.
All right.
In the context of employment, what I'm saying is that there are so many incentives that are given for basically firms below a certain size threshold. It is, whether it's procurement, whether it's priority sector lending, whether it's actually labor law regulation, all of this applies for firms above a certain threshold, which is, and irrespective of their age, which means you could have been, you can be a 40-year-old firm, you know, and yet you basically are, you continue to enjoy the benefits. What does this do? This does is that, as exactly as I was saying, the kid never learns to become an independent biker.
Okay, so tell us, what is it that you're doing to fix that problem?
Yes, so this is your... This is basically the evidence that suggests what can be done.
Yes.
So, Rajasthan changed its labor law in 2014, which is this threshold that was 100 employees increased it to 300. There were a few other changes as well. The survey chapter actually has a table there that talks about it, but this was an important part. Now, for those of you who don't sort of, you know, maybe not necessarily, you know, use this technique, what is called difference in difference. It's a simple, it's used in medical trials where you actually, you have a set of mice which you call a control group, another set of mice which is basically called a treatment group. You give the drug, administer the drug to the one set, also administer basically sugar, you know, sugar water. Why? Because just to take care of this placebo effect, just the fact that you got a drug may make you better. So for many times when you go to a doctor, we basically end up, just by the fact of going to the doctor without even eating any medicine, we may get better, that placebo effect. So in this case, now translate that into this example. Rajasthan is your treatment.
So they did the laws.
Exactly. They changed.
Rest of the country.
They changed the laws.
Not.
Rest of India did not. And what do you see here? This is the cumulative annual growth rate of firms above 100 employees. Why 100? Remember what I said, that the threshold was 100, right? So look at the CAGR for firms. These firms,
that's quote unquote, return.
Cumulative annual growth rate, basically the growth rate at which they're growing. That is about 3.6% before the reform for Rajasthan, increases to 9.33%.
Whereas rest of the country,
is going up from 4.6% to 5.52%. In other words, there is a placebo effect. Overall, because of things that are happening in the country, other things unrelated to this labor reform, the CAGR has been going up.
So the counterfactual is, if Rajasthan had not done it,
exactly,
maybe they would have gone from 3.65 to 4 or 5.
Yes.
But the rest of the stuff must clearly,
yes,
be because, okay.
Correct. Therefore, if I look at, and that's the way, so this is the term that is used, this difference for Rajasthan, which is the treatment,
is bigger,
versus this treatment for the control, is indeed positive, and as we use,
so
statistically significant.
Difference in difference. Okay, so
that is indeed large, and that is the key point, that as that threshold was increased from 100 to 300, those firms that basically were, you know, maybe were below 100 because they wanted to be away from the, you know, the oversight of the labor law, now said, okay, now we've gone to 300, they basically went up. You have from 3.65%.
Okay, tell us quickly, what,
yes,
are you going to do?
Okay, this is the set of, so first thing, this basically means states should be, you know, relaxing their labor laws, number one.
And when?
That is up to the states, because that's, you know, remember, see, this, we have to work within the framework of the Constitution.
But we are in India, you guys have a lot of power over states. You know,
not on the,
oh, come on, you tell that chief minister ko remove kar dunga, they come and do whatever you want. Why can't you do it?
Firstly, Bhagwan, that is above my pay grade.
but not above mine.
So why don't we change roles?
No. I'm an academic, I'm free to say whatever I want.
Absolutely. But let me in the context of nudge, one of the chapters that I basically, you know, in the survey as well, this evidence, you know, should be nudging states, showing if you want, you know, there are good things.
Not nudging. States do not need to be nudged. They need to be. Nudge karne se kya hoga? We've been nudging for 70 years.
I think, no, that is a part which actually gets into areas where I cannot talk much about. You know,
but you can do something. Don't tell us.
Yes.
They're going to invite you again in 2 years and just tell us. Okay?
So let me talk about those that are still within the domain of the central government, which is, there are more.
Central government is very, very powerful. What are you talking about? Who thinks, given the mandate BJP got, that they are not powerful?
At the center, yeah.
Who here thinks that the center is not powerful right now? Come on.
No.
400 seats out of 500.
No. But Bhagwan, remember. See, okay. I think this is at least for all the you know, participants here. You know, the Constitution has basically three lists. There's a central list, there's a state list, and there's a concurrent list. Labor actually is something that does not. There are parts of laws, and you know, which come, and the state center is indeed working on that. There is a uniform wage code that
is
being worked on.
There is persuasion. There are threats.
Absolutely. No. As I said, those. My job as the chief economic advisor is to basically suggest the policy, and then saying, here's the benefits, And this is something that is actually not only economically good, but good in many other ways as well.
Okay.
So go ahead and do it.
Fair enough.
But one more, I think there are a few more things which are important, which is that at the central government itself, what can be done is rather than, you know, continuing to incentivize dwarfs, we can move to incentivizing infants. And that can be done using a sunset clause, saying any policy, any incentive we give is going to be there for 10 years. That makes the particular incentive, you know, age focused. And now with Aadhaar and others that, you know, mechanisms that we have, we can track the age of the firm. Because the problem is, you know, even with that, it's possible that a firm basically up till 9.9 years of, you know, a promoter creates it, makes the, you know, kills the firm, starts another. But you can track all of that stuff. So that's something which can be done.
Like we said, reservations was going to go away in 10 years. Okay. Leave that aside.
If you're going to get me to opine everything under the sun.
No. Okay. I do want to take a chance to ask people questions.
Sure.
But you have to be careful. You can't ask bad questions, okay? No. What I mean is, make your questions really quick and not too long. This is not your chance to give us a lecture. Just ask a question. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Sir, I want to ask, what about the saving rates that fell in the last 5 years and productivity fell in the last, exports fell in the last 5 years?
Okay, quickly. Okay.
So savings,
did savings fall in the last 5 years?
Yeah, but you know, when you look at it, actually the...
Why did they fall?
Yeah, that's what I'm coming to, actually. You know, now you know how bad is it to have Bhagwan as a boss. No, I'm just kidding. It's, you know. So savings rates, actually the financial savings, you know, did not change very much. It's the households' investments, for instance, in real estate or other gold, etc., that fell, you know, because consumption, basically a lot more went into consumption. So it's the financial savings that really matter for investment, and that has not decreased as much. Now, investment actually went down. But that, I think, in other fora I've talked about it, it was primarily an overhang. You know, you had the dual balance sheet problem. You had the, you know, stressed bank balance sheets and the stressed corporate balance sheets, excess capacities that got built up, you know, and all of that. This and winding up that happened.
And you're fixing all that, right?
Yes.
So savings will go up.
Hopefully. Right? Nobody has a magic wand. But
No, but we are trying.
Yes, okay. Absolutely. That okay. I can make a claim.
Okay, let's go to gentleman over here because he's sitting on the floor. So
you referred to the virtuous cycle when you said mobile.
Virtuous cycle.
When you said mobile as a tool of
increasing productivity.
Mobile?
No, the he gave an example.
Just an example.
But you actually waste time on Facebook, right? Is that what you're going
to
say?
No, I'm not going to say that. So productivity is based on the efficiency and effectiveness.
Correct.
So you talked about technology and the small firms. So what are you looking or what are you advising for training?
Okay, training.
As well as for the technology.
Okay, very good point. So okay, training and skilling, what are we going to do?
Training and skilling is an excellent point. You know, it feeds into the virtuous cycle in the following way, that I am really talking about the, in this case, the supply of jobs, right? Saying that, you know, if there is enough investment, there will be jobs created. What you're talking about, actually, skilling is about the demand side. Will we have the people to be able to do those jobs? And I am, you know, it's an important point, which it basically will sort of, you know, really, in some sense, increase the efficiency of this virtuous cycle itself. I'm not going to deny, you know, the import. I have not, you know, in the survey at least, I've not studied it well enough yet.
But the FM did talk about the fact that we should invest in AI, machine learning.
Yes, AI.
But I have a problem with that. Why do I need to hear FM tell me that we need to invest in AI? Private sector is good enough. We can figure it out on our own. Why do we need the government to tell us?
No, see, okay, I think
we know AI is good, right?
Yep.
We know my machine learning is good. Do I need to hear it from in the budget?
Good. So good point, right? I'll actually, and this is something which I mentioned, you know, on Saturday when I was on CNBC. There was a question that came up about R&D.
Yeah.
Now, if you go and look at the patents that are filed by Indian firms, not that many, right? But if you go at the same time look at the R&D, you know, that is used for basically claiming tax breaks, that is substantial. Because one of the things that we, you know, in our literature, Bhagwan, we talk about as well, managerial myopia.
Yeah.
And you know, that is something which actually needs to be. So the reason oftentimes, you know, the government or others need to talk about this is to say, maybe a little bit of a, I mean, nudge/push, that if you have some managements are, you know, are visionary enough to basically say that, yes, innovation is very uncertain, but, you know, in order for me, unless I innovate, I'm not going to be able to basically go and compete in the world markets, and that is what is my vision. But there may be other managements who say, no, let me just stay my tapu zone, you know, I'm comfortable, right? Now, the effort is to try and basically increase the proportion of those that will actually be saying, okay, this is what I need, you know, I need to innovate versus invest in AI, etc.
But what we need to do is just create infrastructure.
Absolutely.
And institutions.
Yes.
But we know it. At ISB, we know innovation is important, so we are going to create entrepreneurship,
yeah,
and as is the rest of the world.
Exactly. And the only role that government should be playing is, and this is something which I keep mentioning, there are a lot of industry participants who come in. The first five slides are basically this tax break, that tax break.
Yeah.
Instead,
I hope you say no to them.
Absolutely.
Instead of saying journalists.
I make it very clear. I tell them, you tell me what are the frictions you face, what are the difficulties you face, and I'm happy to, you know, let's spend our time wisely on that,
okay,
rather than asking me for tax breaks.
Okay, I'm going to go and, we haven't had a woman ask a question. There in the back, yes. Yeah.
Professor, I understand your point where you say the technology would lead to aggregate gain, it would lead to jobs, but that's just a gain at a whole level, like just an aggregate gain. What about a 50-year-old man who's suddenly losing his job because there's technology coming in? Does the government have measures in place to protect those
users?
How do
we take care of the people who are going to lose jobs?
Reskilling, you know, this is something which countries across the world deal with.
That 50-year-old is not going to reskill, right? Are they? No, let's be serious.
I agree. But some
should
where the social sector.
Should we instead create some kind of a
pension schemes for are being created?
Scheme.
Actually, the safety nets are important. But, you know, together with that, you also provide. See, there are people, 50-year-olds whom I know, who actually are willing to learn. The person is willing to learn, give them incentives to actually go in, but create the social safety net as well.
And for the young people, in fact, we should change the narrative so that they don't stop learning. That
absolutely.
They get a job. They
absolutely
have to continue learning
yeah
throughout their life.
No, you
so
got
this idea
yeah
that, you know, first you go to school, then you do job. It has to change.
You got to, no, I think I'll, you know, just on my own personal, see, I, to write this survey, I had to learn a ton of macroeconomics, you know, go and read the papers because, you know, that's not an area that I had worked on, you know, earlier. And you got to keep learning continuously.
You didn't take the class? At
took
ISB?
The class.
Okay, just kidding. There were some people on this side I'm ignoring. Yes, lady over in the back.
Rate of interest?
No. Rate of interest is actually falling.
Yeah.
But the real rates may not be.
Yeah.
So, you know, people get confused. They say, oh, interest rates has fallen, but inflation has fallen too.
Yeah.
So it's not so bad.
It's
say it again.
No,
quickly.
I think, you know, say it again. Say it again.
No, but these
no
things are determined jointly.
Yeah.
Right? It's not just one or the other.
Yeah.
He's
yeah
saying that we need to
let me try and clarify. Maybe what I said may not have been very clear. All I'm saying is, if we have to invest, we need to tap into savings. The savings could be domestic savings,
could be
foreign savings as well. Now, there are trade-offs, as you must have learned, with any of those. The trade-off with domestic savings is, if there is you're going to tap into a lot of domestic savings, obviously, the people cannot consume as much, right? Then where is the demand for investment going to come? That's the part with the domestic savings. With foreign savings, you can tap into it, but it can create some macro vulnerability. Therefore, you have to look for that sweet spot, which is, you know, that's the point I'm trying to say. That you basically, in order to trigger this virtuous cycle, let's tap into foreign investment, but let's not really make, you know, go too far on that, because the other side, the trade-off, which is the macroeconomic, we have to be wary about that as well.
Okay. The young lady in the maroon shirt here. No, wait. Yes.
I have a question on the innovation part. So you talked about, you know, this less patenting and on innovation. what are we doing to incentivize indigenous firms and also foreign firms to innovate in India? I think that's like hugely lacking. You have patents in the academia, but not in the private sector.
Not in academia either.
So what are we doing to?
Okay, so I think in the you know,
the angel tax is gone.
The budget there was actually a slew of measures for startups, and we know very well that innovation and entrepreneurship are quite correlated. So the set of measures there actually is, you know, the angel tax is gone. There is the category 2 of investments, angel investments, basically have been provided the same status as category 1, so that, you know, investments can come in. There are a few others, I think, you know, set of measures for startups, including some of these are the key ones that have been talked about.
I hope you will go bold and not have these categories and this rule and that. So just say no tax for startups, period. I mean, that's very easy to understand. Otherwise, I have to say, am I category 2?
But Bhagwan, see, actually, I'll tell you what, right? This is the, you know, having now been there for 6-7 months, right? There are a bunch of ways. So in other words, let me put it this way. I have found that policy making is this trade-off between the malafide and the bona fide, which is that, you know, you create a policy, there are a bunch of, you know, for instance, this happened with SEZs, where there was tax breaks that was given, you know, for SEZs. A lot of business that would have not traditionally been in SEZs were also routed into SEZs. So it's like a cat and mouse game that gets played. Now what do? You basically go and, in fact, the angel tax itself was something like that, where there was a provision. Now, if you look at shell firms versus startups, to the, you know, oftentimes even to the trained eye, they may not look very different in terms of just the characteristics. So you know, because you create a law and then people basically try and, you know, create some other way, then you respond to it. And that's why oftentimes what happens is, and let me finish that collateral damage gets created for bona fides many times. Yeah. But I wonder what is the, you know, in a real world scenario, that it's very hard to just, you know, virtues cannot be legislated, right?
And that's why we shouldn't. Maybe we should, in order to prevent a thief, if you're also going to prevent a grocery wala, then, you know, you're throwing the baby out with the bathwater.
But
we have to,
I agree, Bhagwan, but at the same time, see, especially after, you know, when I was doing my PhD versus after the financial crisis, my view on, you know, on markets versus roll off has basically gotten moderated. I am not as big on saying just laissez-faire.
We will have a discussion on this after I've had a glass of wine. Yes, yes. The gentleman there, yes. With...
When all economic indicators are going down, like auto sales or even income levels, and then shampoo sales are down for the first time, auto sales are down, and then essential commodity sales are coming down,
it is the time to really worry. But what is giving you so much confidence that we are going to double our... we are going to achieve $5 trillion. Are you expecting a V-shaped recovery? Aren't we going to spend some time here, maybe 1 year or 18 months before recovering? So from where that confidence is coming?
Okay, good question. So I, having now observed the Indian economy for close to 2 decades, I have come to the view that, you know, the truth is always in between. 2008, 2009, we were so irrationally exuberant that if we do nothing, we'll continue to grow at 9%. That irrational exuberance was not right. Neither is it the case that today, you know, your comment seems to suggest that basically, you know, India is going to the dogs. You know, neither is that, let me finish. Neither is that, is this pessimism correct either? The truth is somewhere in between. Yes, 5.8% was the Q4 growth. But, and you know, and this is something, even though this is unrelated, I will make this comment. I get asked this question a lot about, you know, about data. Let me make it very, very clear. Actually, having been there for 7 months, India is a democracy. You know, there are so many touch points for policies that if you try to develop a narrative that is different from the truth, somebody will squeal. Why? Because unlike some other countries, if you squeal, you're not going to basically find yourself dropping dead tomorrow. Okay, the reason I'm saying this is that on the one hand, people say, oh, maybe your data is not right. If suppose we're trying to develop a narrative that is different from the truth, the incentive to fudge would have been the maximum and the growth rate is 5.8%, right?
You can't have, on the one hand, say that, oh, economy is slowing down. If you basically want to fudge the numbers, you would fudge when the growth rates are low. Let me, even with the Q4 growth, our average growth rate for the year was 6.8%. And among all, you know, large economies, this is something which is, you know, which is true. And the last point, which is, you know, we issued a technical note as well. Even if we actually debate about GDP levels, growth rates, you know, any change in the levels doesn't necessarily translate into growth rates. Growth rate was 6.8%, which means it is not as bad as you're making it out to be, nor was it as good when we were thinking that we're going to grow at 9%. It is my job, someone like me in this role, to point out what is basically that, you know, be wise enough to look through the leaves and say this is what is the truth.
Okay. We are coming to an end, so I want to ask you a personal question, which is, I've known you for many years, you're, you know, dear friend, and people look at you and say, oh, he went to the US, he went to University of Chicago, but you had very humble beginnings.
Yes, very much.
Tell us a story about your father you told me once. I think I was very moved when I heard that. I think you told me that your father had one pair of shoes or something like that.
Yeah, no, in fact, you know, he never had a pair of shoes till I started working and I bought him a pair of shoes. So
you understand. So when you're talking about
absolutely,
this thing,
absolutely.
It's not like you're sitting in this ivory tower or in North Block.
No.
This is something
inside you. I am not among those, that crowd that basically can sit in AC rooms and forget about, actually, because I've lived it. My father, you know, was a voracious reader, but he lost his father when he was 7 years old. And therefore, he could just barely complete his education because of his, you know, his siblings actually supporting, and that's how he did what is called SSLC. And he started in, you know, in the Indian Railways as a clerk. And in fact, while he was waiting for the Railway Service Commission results to come in, he actually started working, you know, in railways itself as actually a class 4 employee.
Yeah.
And from there, he rose to become a gazetted officer, retired as a gazetted officer. So,
how sweet is that, guys?
And that's the, and you know, he
made sure that you got education.
Absolutely.
And your brother.
No, in fact, actually, he emphasized, you know, I remember as a young kid, right, when we were basically used to go out, so we used to, you know, in a small town, we used to go out in these rickshaws. And he would just reel off titles after the other. So he used to, his dream was for me to be a doctor. He'd say MBBS, MD, FRCP, bunch. That's what you'd basically. So, you know, in some sense, I'm just so grateful to him that.
He instilled the values.
He instilled.
That you carry with you today.
Absolutely. One of the key values that he instilled, which actually is what made me go into academia. I made this choice when I was graduating from IIM Calcutta to go into research. Because one thing that he used to say, I mean, I articulated actually in this using these words, but he used to said, if your only ambition in life is to be rich, it shows an extreme poverty of ambition. Okay. And that is a credo. That is the credo by which I've actually lived my life. And that the reason I came back from the United States was because I did not want to write papers that basically a few hundred people will read. It's valuable. I'm going to. How about
only 10 people read the papers like I write?
Maybe. I do want to, you know, be given how tough it is, and we know that 3.5% acceptance rates, which most people outside here don't know, publishing in that, it is, you have to earn your stripes. But I did not want to spend my life just doing that, which I write something that is read by 100 people. And I wanted to be back here and actually influencing policy in whatever way. Now, to be honest with you, I did not anticipate that I'll get an opportunity like this. But the desire was there too.
And lest we forget, we should remember that behind every successful man, there is a woman.
Absolutely.
Your wife.
No, in fact,
also went to University of Chicago.
Yes,
she's
very
an MBA.
Much. Yes.
She works at ISB for us for many years.
She manages the MBA programs here, you know, okay.
And I know that you have written many things about her.
Very, very, you know, I think
and,
I've been.
And your daughter, is she following you? Where is she going?
Yeah, she's going to the University of Chicago.
She's going to go to
the
University of Chicago to follow her dad. And
yeah, no, I must actually.
How old is your son?
My son is in now ninth grade.
And one of the things. Do you think he feels any pressure?
My daughter, I think, you know, all of us agree that, you know, our kids do feel some pressure. But I've been lucky to have, especially my wife, you know, she's been very, very supportive.
We are very, very proud of you both as Indians and ISB colleagues. Please give them a big round of applause.
Thank you.
And I just want you to know that you're not alone. We are all there for you. Whenever you need us,
yeah,
we'll be there.
No, in fact, actually, if you have ideas, you know, one of the things I do is that while my office takes care of all the logistical emails, if there's an email with an idea that comes, I make sure I read it. And I hear that many ideas are actually oftentimes not practical, but that's how by looking at 10 ideas, you know, you get two of those gems. And so please feel free to, you know.
I would request Dean Rashivasa to give him a small token so that he remembers that he is still part of ISB.
Of course. That,
okay.
You know.
Thank you all for coming. And if you're watching on Facebook Live, thank you all for watching. This conversation shall continue. We will keep inviting Subbu back to ISB from time to time.
And Subbu, remember you're on leave.
Yes, I am very much on leave. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. No, I mean, I can never forget that it's ISB that made me whatever I am.
So, really incredible. Thanks so much. And, you know, thanks to the audience.
Yes, absolutely.